Hey guys, it's Mike Chen. Now, when I mention secret laboratories, do you picture like a hidden lair inside a volcano or some laboratory deep inside a mountain or in the middle of a desert? But would you ever think that there's a secret lab in a bustling, tourist-filled area of a major city? That would be really genius, right? And guys, that does actually exist inside a popular monument. Now, the monument is a famous Doric column situated nearby the equally iconic London Bridge in England's historical city of, well, London. This 202-foot stone column features a striking figure of a flaming golden orb, and both this high structure and the orb serve to commemorate the Great Fire of 1666. Huh, Great Fire, 666. Anyway, the monument stands at a site located between Fish Street Hill and the Monument Street, which is 202 feet away from the bakery of one Thomas Farriner in Pudding Lane. This humble shop of the King's Baker was where the Great Fire started on the second day of September in 1666, and it ended up setting ablaze the magnificent London skyline of the 17th century. But unbeknownst to a lot of people, the monument to the Great Fire of London was constructed to serve another purpose. Believe it or not, the column itself was designed to function as a colossal zenith telescope. And aside from that, it housed a hidden laboratory where various scientific experiments were supposedly conducted. So who created this and what was it used for? Well, the name of renowned architect Sir Christopher Wren is what is inscribed on a plaque attached to the column's base, but the monument was originally designed by Robert Hooke, dubbed as England's Leonardo da Vinci and celebrated during his time as the world's greatest mechanic. Hooke is credited for a lot of scientific achievements. Not only did he build the first renowned reflecting telescope, he was also responsible for inventing the universal joint. Not what you're thinking of, which is commonly used in motor vehicles. He was also the one who came up with, well, Hooke's law of elasticity and the originator of the term cell in referring to biological life's most basic units. His other mechanical inventions included the iris diaphragm and the balance wheel, items used in cameras and watches respectively. Though he gained renown for being a man of science, Hooke also dabbled in architecture, tasked with designing churches, hospitals, and other civic structures. And one of the architectural structures he was appointed to design and build was the monument, which was meant to be a grand effort to immortalize the Great Fire. However, at the time he was handed the project, Hooke was fixated on proving the scientific and controversial theory that it's actually the Earth that revolves around the Sun and not the other way around. But at the end, he really saw no reason why the two objectives couldn't be accomplished all in a single effort. To Hooke, this meant building a structure that commemorated the Great Fire of London, but at the same time functioned as a very large long telescope. And in order for Hooke to prove the Earth did revolve around the Sun, it was important for him to devise a way to track and measure the movement of various objects in space. And this meant being able to observe the shift or changes in the position of one celestial object against the background of another. Today, astronomers refer to this method as astronomical parallax, and it entails partitioning the heavens in accordance to an imaginary face of a clock. And the hands of the clock will be used to determine how far a particular celestial object is. Now, observing this parallax cannot be done using only the naked eye, which was why Hooke needed to build a huge telescope. And to realize his vision of building this telescope, it was imperative for Hooke that the monument be a stable and sturdy structure. So he intended for the monument to be made of only the finest Portland stones, and his plans required 28,196 cubic feet of these stones. Construction of the entire column took around 6 years to complete, and there were a lot of bumps along the way. One problem was that building the monument, like I mentioned, required a lot of Portland stone along with other building stones, but they were always in short supply because after the Great Fire, a lot of things were destroyed and had to be rebuilt. And the King, Charles II, thought it was prudent to regulate the transportation of these rocks from the Isle of Portland, and he consequently issued a proclamation that everything involving Portland stone must first be consulted with Sir Christopher Wren, who was the royal appointed architect of the project, which explained why his name is on the plaque. Another issue that almost ruined Hooke's plans for the monument was the suggestion that a statue of the King should be placed on top of the column. Fortunately, the King refused to have a depiction of himself be the centerpiece of a monument, as it might give the wrong impression that he was to blame for the fire. So in the end, Hooke managed to build the monument in the way that he originally pictured it, finishing it in 1677. And since the column of the monument doubled as a telescope, Hooke equipped the structure with two giant lenses which were aligned with each other and were 200 feet apart. And he planned to view the heavens using a telescope from an underground laboratory. But a lot of this didn't really work out the way he planned, because although Hooke had big ambitions for the monument, monuments when it comes to conducting various scientific experiments. Unfortunately, utilizing the monument as a telescope proved incredibly difficult because for one, it was hard to affix the giant lenses to the telescope. And what's worse is that the location of the monument is not really ideal because it's basically in a high traffic area. So there was a lot of vibrations coming from the heavy traffic and made it impossible to record accurate measurements. And eventually Hooke knew that he had to abandon his plans to use the building as a telescope, and it would take years and a German astronomer named Frederick Basel before parallax was finally discovered in 1838. But the value of the monument in scientific research did not end with its failure to properly function as a gigantic telescope. During the 17th century, high-rise structures were a rarity, and before the monument was built, Hooke had to conduct his physics experiments, which required height from the top of other tall structures like the Westminster Abbey. So when he finished the column, it was like he had a huge laboratory all to himself where he could test all the theories he wanted to involving height or altitude. And of course, centuries have already passed since Hooke used the monument as his science lab. Nowadays, the structure is a popular tourist attraction with over 230,000 people visiting it annually. And like I mentioned, still, this will be the perfect mad scientist laboratory. His or her lair is never like in the middle of the city. It's kind of like a mad evil genius trying to take over New York. And he's got an office like right in the middle of Times Square. I mean, who would ever think to look there? Anyway, guys, I thought this topic was really interesting, so I wanted to share with you all. Thank you all so much for watching this video. I'll see you later.